When Kiss started performing in the 70s, the band became famous for its look as well as its music. They paint their faces in bold black and white patterns that seem inspired by comic book superheroes and villains. They also dress outrageously in wardrobes that include giant platform shoes, breastplates, and cod pieces. The band has been the subject of comic books and movies and has had all kinds of merchandising tie-ins. Now Gene Simmons has a best-selling memoir called Kiss and Makeup. Gene Simmons is his stage name. He was born in Israel in 1949, the son of a Holocaust survivor. When he was 10, he moved with his mother to Queens, New York. There he dropped his Hebrew name and became Gene Klein. Gene Simmons, welcome to Fresh Air.
Thank you.
Let's start with the makeup. Did you like being covered up on stage? Did it make you feel any less vulnerable or any less like Gene Simmons or your other names, Gene Klein or Chaim Weitz, which was your birth name?
Close, but no guitars. It's Chaim Witz.
Oh, thanks. Okay.
You said it. Well, the name came out through Gentile mouth, so it didn't quite have the flavor. It came out bland.
Well, it's not a Gentile mouth.
Ooh. Maybe it's a discussion we can have.
Yeah, okay.
But let's not start something we're not going to finish.
Right.
But in terms of the... what was the question about makeup?
Oh, did you like being covered up by makeup, and did it make you feel less vulnerable or... You know, less like Gene Simmons, Gene Klein, or your birth name.
I don't feel covered up any more or less than any girl feels covered up when she wears makeup. The makeup is simply an extension of a personality, and colors, clothing, makeup all express something. And getting up on stage was a chance to sort of live out the, sort of a scream therapy meets a rock and roll band version. I wanted to put together the band I never saw on stage. I wanted to be in a band that gave bang for the buck. I wanted to be in a band that didn't look like a bunch of guys who, you know, should be in a library studying for their finals. You know, I wanted stars up on stage, and regular people just didn't look big enough. So we wore 8-inch platform heels, put on more makeup and higher heels than your mother, and made more money than your banker. It all kind of works out.
Did you pattern your makeup on comic book heroes?
My makeup came as a result of a lot of things, all things Americana. Godzilla, horror movies, science fiction, Black Bolt, which was an Inhumans Marvel comic book, and science fiction, certainly. So it's comic books, all things sort of American pop culture. The rest of the guys in the band had different notions. Paul put on the red lips and the star over his eyes, a kind of a exaggeration of what he thought a rock star was, because he always wanted to be a rock star. I was never interested in being a rock star. I always wanted to be Boris Karloff. And Ace, who's the spaceman in the group, you know, has delusions of grandeur, and perhaps gravity doesn't quite affect him in the same way, which is to say that he doesn't have good equilibrium, which is a big word, come to think of it, just like gymnasium. This is NPR. That's why we're using big words.
How would you describe the pattern on your face?
A banker's pattern. When you look at it, it says, boy, that guy's got a lot of money. You know why I'm pulling your leg? Because I can't touch it from where I am. This is a serious kind of...
We'll get to that a little later.
Yeah, I'm not going to play
we'll
the
We'll get to tally a little later.
Because this is all... After all, it means very little. I'm in a weird band. We've done very well. The American Dream is alive and well. And in terms of what it all means, it's sort of academic, really. It's about two guys from the intelligentsia, which is not the intelligence service, who sit around and sort of contemplate their navel. At the end of the day, it means nothing. At the end of the day, food tastes good. I like it or I don't like it. And Kiss, yeah, I like him or I don't like him. That's a conversation, and it's never-ending. But what you can't argue with is the American notion, which is of the people, for the people, by the people. They vote with money. You and I, we sit here and we just talk and toss the ball around. That doesn't mean a lot.
Are you trying to say to me that all that matters to you is money?
I will contend, and you try to disprove it, that the most important thing as we know it on this planet and this plane is, in fact, money. You want me to prove it?
Go ahead.
The first thing you need besides air, which so far is free, and by the way, if you went scuba diving, you're paying for air. The other thing besides that is food. It's what we need to survive. I don't know what other tool I would use besides money to buy it. Although, as a woman, of course, you have the ability to sell your body then get the money, and then with that get food. But ultimately, money is part of it.
You are weird.
Really? How do you get food?
Well, not by selling my body, but...
But that's a choice you have that I don't. But getting to the money part, money is the single most important thing on the planet, including the notion that love gives you everything. It's a load of hogwash, mm-hmm. because although I subscribe to the romantic notion of life...
Well, let's
get
to the chase. How much money do you have?
Gee, a lot more than NPR.
I know. You're very defensive on money, aren't you?
No, I'm not. I'm actually just trying to show you that there's a big world out there, and reading books is wonderful. I've certainly read, well, perhaps as many as you have, but there's a delusional kind of notion that runs rampant in...
Wait, can we just get something straight?
Of course.
I'm not here to prove that I'm smart, and I'm not here to prove that you're not smart or that you don't read books or can't make a lot of money.
This is not about you. You're being very defensive. Why are you doing that?
It's contagious.
Yeah.
Can we get back to your makeup? What do you use to paint your face, and do you ever break out from it?
No, it's actually oil-based. It's Stein's makeup is one of the brand names, but you can use lots of things. I don't think I've ever been asked that question, but no, my skin is more beautiful than yours. I would be quite more popular in jail if I so chose.
What do you do to take the makeup off? What do you use?
You use Pons. You know, the same stuff women do, or you can use a Stein's concoction, which is, you know, sort of similar but more industrious. Industrial. Industrious means sort of ambitious. Industrial in strength.
Now, clothes that you've worn on stage include fishnet stockings, spike platform.
That's
boots.
Actually untrue.
No?
No. Better research needed. Fire your research person. No fishnet stockings. Never. Not in this band.
Oh, I'm sure I saw you.
We catch fish with fishnets.
I was sure I saw you in them. But that's
no,
all right. I trust you. I trust you on that.
Don't ever do that. I'm a man.
Now, let's get to the studded codpiece. Do you have a sense
of
humor about that? I mean, does that seem funny to you?
No, it holds in my manhood. Otherwise,
yes, right.
It would be too much for you to take. You'd have to put the book down and confront life. The notion is that if you want to welcome me with open arms, I'm afraid you're also going to have to welcome me with open legs.
That's a really obnoxious thing to say.
No, it's not. Why should I say something behind your back that I can't tell you to your face?
Wait, has it come to this? Is this the only way that you can talk to a woman, to do that shtick?
Let me ask you something. Why is it shtick when all women have ever wanted, ever since we've crawled out of caves, is why can't a man just tell me the truth and just speak to me plainly? So if I do that, you can't have it both ways.
So you really have no sense of humor about this, do you?
Oh, I'm laughing all the way, you know.
Oh, to the bank, right?
Well, of course. Don't I sound like a happy guy?
Not really, to be honest with you.
I was going to suggest you get outside of the musty place where you can count the dust particles falling around you and get out in the world and see what everybody else is doing.
Having sex with you?
Well, if you chose, but you'd have to stand in line.
Well, that's the thing. We might as well get to this since you keep bringing it up. Yeah, you've had 4,000...
I didn't, actually. You did.
You write in your book you've had 4,600 sexual liaisons over the years.
You're supposed to say so far.
So far.
Right.
To you, this will be asking the obvious, but why have you wanted so many encounters?
I can only spell it in three letters, M-A-N. When a woman... And look, I'm not here to say that I'm a scientist or... pretend or portend to be anything else. Those are semantics, of course, but then neither you nor I are anti-semantic. The notion is plain. And I read a book called Myth of Monogamy, which actually sort of approached the subject and verbalized it. And I finally understood what it was, because every woman suspects that the man she's laying next to is not necessarily going to be, well, faithful is the word. And privately she tells her girlfriends, oh, God, all men are dogs. You're correct. And I'm here to tell you that in my deluded perspective, perhaps, it's biological. The first, quote, man and women, if man was predisposed to be monogamous, and we all lived in caves at that point, there were one or two alpha males and the rest were females. Either way, If we were monogamous within one or two generations, we would all be cross-eyed and retarded. Get it?
So, let me ask this. You say you've had sex with about 4,600 people, women.
Women, yes.
You actually count? I mean, do you have like a book in which
you know,
you,
I, you know,
hash
I never
marks
paid,
for?
I never paid much attention to it because I've always lived my life the way my mother taught me to live it, which is that every day above ground is a good day. Don't look over your shoulder at society's rules or whether or not you please anybody else except you, because at the end of your life, right before they stick you underground, you can't go into the woulda, coulda, shoulda. You can't do that great Jewish joke. What's a great Jewish wine? I want to go to Palm Springs. Doesn't fly. You're responsible for your own happiness, and women have to get that notion over. Don't look to your guy. You have to figure out what makes you happy. And I did a long time ago. I'm an only child, and I had a lot of time to figure it out. And so what I figured out a long time ago was every day should be enjoyable. A, if you will, Epicurean hedonist. Look it up in your Funkin' Wagnalls. And what it means is life is the pursuit of pleasure, and I've done very well pursuing it. And so the band has been around 30 years. We're right behind the Beatles in the number of gold records by any groups in history. Somebody likes us. Women and their sisters and their moms seem to want to express their adoration and or fan worship, or perhaps they want to see if my oral appendage actually does have a spin and dry cycle and whether or not it has the ability to actually whip up a good froth. Ladies, I'm here to tell you it does. So for whatever reason they deem me worthy of their companionship, I was more than glad to oblige. And so almost 30 years ago I started taking photos, Polaroids. And I still have them to this day. And so when the book was being written, Crown Publishers, who published my book, wanted to know, you know, you can't just say I did this and I did that. You've got to give specifics. So I sat down and started counting. One, two, and so on. And arrived at around 4,600 and change.
Mm-hmm. Are you interested in music, or is the goal of being in a rock band to have sex a lot?
I believe in my heart that anybody who gets up there and says what they're doing is art is on crack and is delusional, and that in point of fact what they really, their modus operandi initially, perhaps it changed when they started to question their sexuality, but clearly initially it was to get laid and make lots of money. And anybody who tells you otherwise is lying to you. The reason we all wanted to pick up instruments initially, you know, publicly anyway, I will grant you there are those people who really love music and simply want to do it as a private pleasure. The jury is out. I have no comment. But as soon as you get up publicly and want other people to hear it, it seems odd that we really get off on the notion that the opposite sex, the fairer sex, that's you, like what we do. And perhaps if we do it really well, you'll think, gee, he's not only talented and bright, but it's kind of cute, too. That's what we're hoping for. Against all odds. And in music, it's the great aphrodisiac that says that even though I'm short, fat, ugly, bald, and I'm hung like a second grader, if I'm in a rock band, I've got a better than average chance of bedding you down than if I was a dentist. I didn't make those rules. I come from Israel. I'm simply a student at your feet. This is what I've noticed.
Are you interested in music?
Don't you
at
love
all?
This interview? Tell me the truth.
Well, I think it's kind of a drag because you're making speeches and you're being intentionally
right.
Obnoxious.
No, I'm not. I'm being a man.
That's what I mean. You're being intentionally obnoxious by defining everything that you're saying as
for me,
being a man.
Well, I can't
I
talk.
I know better. I know all men.
No.
Define the way that you're speaking.
You're wrong. I always defined it as for me. I kept doing that over and over again. What bothers you is you're finally hearing a man tell the truth. Instead of, you're the only one I'll ever live with, and you're the... He's lying. He's lied ever since he was 12. I promise I'll pull out. He's lying. And I refuse to play that game. I refuse to stand up in front of a rabbi and my friends and the woman I love, who I will tell you I can love with all my heart, and promise that she's going to be the only one I will ever have until the day I die. That's a lie.
Do you like the movie Spinal Tap? And do you think that the Spinal Tap has any comment on
rock and roll?
Like
sure.
Uh-huh.
Oh yeah. Sure. I think it's all funny. I mean, when you really think about it, I'm not delusional enough to think that what I do is important to life as we know it on this planet. No, but neither is what you do. You know, the world can get along very well without us. Farmers are more important, teachers and firemen and so on, because if they're not around, it really affects us. Your job and my job, whether you wear less makeup and I wear more makeup, is to entertain people. And I'm here to tell you, I'm very entertaining. I don't know about you, but this is NPR.
What exactly is NPR in your mind?
I never knew. It always sounds like a sixth grade school teacher. See, if I was in charge, give me the reins, I would get National Public Radio. People start snoring. I'm not questioning the content. You should have bright people on. Maybe you should never have me on again if you don't think I'm bright. Clearly, it should be a wonderful place for people who read and are bright to have a conversation, a discourse perhaps, without hearing whatever it is you hate about the outside world. Fine. How about some style? Give me a little spice instead of this bland. You ever see the Saturday Night Live version? It's pretty spot on.
Have you listened to it enough to know if it's spot on?
Sure. I was in Los Angeles and did a quick one. P.J. O'Rourke, who's great, who wrote for Rolling Stone, was on with myself and one other gentleman, I don't remember, and the DJ guy gets on, "Good afternoon, Gene." Going, "What's the matter? Why are you talking like that?" "What do you mean?" Going, "You know what? Let P.J. talk. P.J. the DJ. You need, as a listener, I would beg you guys to get something else on the air. Something with style. I change the call letters, NPR. I change it. Give it some oomph, Lexus, Locus, something. See?
Well, I'm going to get back to some questions about KISS, and we'll see where we get to. One of the things you've done on stage is your fire eating. How and why did you start doing that?
So that people can say, wow, look at him fire breathe, you know. Why does anybody, why does a little boy put a frog in a little girl's hands? Because she screeches and goes, ah!
Did you learn from magicians how to do it?
Yes, I learned from a guy named Magico, who was actually, warned me about everything. And the first time I tried it, I burned the corner of my hair. And it was very, very dangerous and continues to be. Uh-huh.
What about throwing up blood? Did you consult a magician for that, too, or a special effects guy?
Nope. It's when nobody's looking, fill your mouth full of it and get into it. But what does it all mean? Nothing. It means for 2 hours, we're going to make you forget about the traffic jam and the fact that your girlfriend is whining or whatever else is going on in your life. And for 2 hours, we give you escapism. That's what it means.
What was the age of your audience when KISS started to perform?
That's a good question, because in 1972 or 73, when we first started, it was late teens, and I'd say 18 to 20, 60 to 70% male. And then when KISS became the number one band, within a year and a half, we were playing Anaheim Stadium, and we had toys, games, comic books, everything you can imagine. The age really widened, and we had fans as young as 3 years old. And then through the 80s and stuff, the audience got older as we did less toys, less comic books, and so on. And now in the 90s and, of course, through the 2000 era, we've got over 2,500 licenses. There's a KISS Broadway play on the way with Rob Roth, who directed Beauty and the Beast, a KISS cartoon show with the people who do Transformers and Beast Wars. In other words, there are KISS comic books in the works. Superman meets KISS. That's going to be the kickoff of the new the new KISS comic book series. So we're going everywhere. I can be on the cover of Playboy magazine, and I can sell comic books and bubblegum to younger fans, and it's all good. And instead of being in a rock and roll band, who the hell wants to do that? I don't. I want to be in a rock and roll brand. I want to be Disney without the overhead. And I'm on the way.
Let's talk about your background. You were born in Israel. Several years after the war ended, your mother, during the war, was in a Nazi concentration camp. Do you have any memories of life in Israel?
I do. The German Nazi concentration camps during World War II, which the entire German population, or enough of it that you can say the German population, bought into hook, line, and sinker, was a result of my mother's and millions of other people's misery. And Israel was a strange place anyway. It was certainly not an easy place to go to. But 6 months after the, quote, independence of Israel, as recognized by the UN and who knows who else, I popped out. So where I was born was really an accident, just like everybody else. And growing up in Israel was sort of being in a box where you're not aware that the outside world exists. I certainly never saw a television set. I didn't know about Kleenex or supermarkets or anything. All I knew was you heard stories in school about David and Goliath and, you know, all these wonderful, great superheroic stories, and the sea is splitting open and wide, and our people go through it, and then it crashes again on the Egyptians, and, you know, all these great stories. But and then slowly people started to tell me, no, this is the place that happened. You're actually living in it. So it was tough to take in. So at 8 and a half years of age, when I came over to America with my mother, it was like being thrown into another dimension. I had never heard of Santa Claus or Christ or Christmas, never knew anything about Christians or that there were other kinds of people. And from then on, I became a sponge. I wanted to just take it all in. It was just way beyond anything I could ever imagine. And television, the great television, and rock and roll and horror movies and science fiction and comic books were my education. And I thank God that those were what I learned instead of having to read Jane Eyre at an early age, because it wasn't anything I could relate to.
I know you went to a yeshiva as a boy. Were you from an Orthodox family?
No, nobody in the family was Orthodox, but when I came to America, my mother, being a single mother, had to go out and work from 6 in the morning till 7 at night, so she put me in a yeshiva, which is a Jewish theological seminary. In other words, you're studying to be somebody, and I was studying to be a rabbi. And they fed me and clothed me, and, you know, you sort of take care of your child. That way you don't have to worry that your child is on the street. And so while I was there, I saw one world, the closed world, and when I turned on television, people were flying through the air, and they had capes, and there were cartoons, and, you know, just amazing things. And I wanted to go there. I thought that was a lot cooler than yarmulkes.
What's your mother's reaction to KISS?
Well, it's interesting. Good question. My mother is probably the wisest person I've ever known. She's not schooled. She's not well-read. And yet she has a philosophy about life that makes well-read people seem like morons. She doesn't talk a lot, uses very few words to express herself, unlike myself, who likes the sound of his own voice. So here's a woman who'd been through the German Nazi concentration camps of World War II and still thought that there was goodness in humanity, and thought about the fact that the glass was half full instead of half empty. And when asked about, well, what about your son? You know, he's in this weird rock band. He dresses weird and, you know, apparently has lots of liaisons and girls and stuff. What do you think about that? She goes, well, as long as he doesn't use drugs and alcohol and doesn't hurt anybody, I don't care about the rest. You know what? She's right.
Well, you said that you don't use drugs and you've never had a drink of alcohol.
That's not true. I've never been drunk.
You've never been drunk. That's right, yeah.
No.
Yeah.
I literally, you know, at parties when somebody says toast, I try to take a sip, but without saying it for effect, it's true, as soon as I smell alcohol, I start to gag. I may be blessed with some kind of chemical reaction against it, but I won't go near the most beautiful woman who's got my name written all over her. If she opens her mouth and smells like a truck driver who just drank Bud, I'm out of there, gone. It always struck me bizarre that women are willing to paint their mouths beautifully with lipstick and yet smoke and drink and make their breath smell like a garbage heap. So I can't do that. I can't be around people who numb their senses. Everybody's allowed, as far as I'm concerned, to take their own life or numb themselves to oblivion. I could care less. I have no sympathy for anybody who lives in America especially, and who decides, you know what, I'm going to numb myself. Drugs, alcohol, cigarettes. So I'm happy to be alive every single day, and I want my senses working 24 hours a day. And if you were in my room and we were going to have a liaison and you were high, you'd be out on your butt before you could spell your last name. Because if you don't want to experience me with all the senses God gave you, you don't deserve to be with me.
You said you don't have sympathy for that guy on the roof who keeps saying I'm going to jump. My impression is you don't have much sympathy for anyone. You're so into yourself. You're just so deep into yourself.
I think everybody should be. If it sounds like admiration coming out of you, I accept it. I think life is too short to have anything but delusional notions about yourself, which is you should really like yourself more than you deserve to, because the alternative isn't very good. You should really think you are better looking than you are, because the alternative is sort of, you know, some bad notions. And so I'm aware, as a sane person, that I'm not the best looking guy in the world. I'm aware of it. But when I go into a party, I will walk out with your girlfriend.
Just one more question before we wrap up.
I
would like to think that the personality you've presented on our show today is a persona that you've affected as a member of KISS, something that you do on stage and before the microphone, but mm-hmm. that you're not nearly as obnoxious in the privacy of your own home or when you're having dinner with friends.
Fair enough. And I'd like to think that the boring lady who's talking to me now is a lot sexier and more interesting than the one who's doing NPR, you know, studious and reserved. And I bet you're a lot of fun at a party.
Well, we'll leave it at that. Gene Simmons,
sure.
Thanks so much.
I look forward to our meeting.
Bye-bye.